speakers. Shakti Munshi ji is an environmentalist and a human rights analyst. I'm the vice president of the Mumbai chapter of Jammu and Kashmir Study Center. She was a permanent invite and a board member of the Kashmiri Pandit Association previously. And our other speaker is Dr. Vijay Sazawal. He's a policy analyst and a commentator who specializes in local governance and intra-community issues affecting political dynamics, especially within the Kashmir Valley. Yeah. So one quick announcement before Shakti starts with her commentary is we will hand out a piece of paper for questions. So if you can note down your questions and we will take it, and then based on the number of questions we'll prioritize for the questions to be asked in the end.
Shall we? First of all, let's thank FIIDS and all of you for coming here, but I'll cut it short to all the thank yous. And I'll start from where he left. He's giving you a good picture of Pakistan, you know, what kind of a state that is. Then Baluchistan of India, yeah, he's told you of the atrocities that are happening there. I also want to tell you Maharaja, the Raja of Kalal, wanted to accede to India, you know. But at that time he was refused because he did not have a land connectivity. And he said, if we can have East Pakistan and West Pakistan, why can't we have East India and West India? You know? But then we are, according to the Government of India Act 1935, there were certain rules set down on how it happens, and that was a part of British India that was done. And this was a princely state, so the accession was not allowed. You know, that's the time. So now coming to his sufferings, it's moved me a lot. But then now coming to Kashmir, he said the Kashmir belonged now to the Kashmiris. I'll give you a little brief about the history of Kashmir. Because what happens is, when we talk of truth, you know, truth becomes, facts become everybody's truth. But there are fantasies, nobody's truth, you know. And there are myths which become somebody's truth. And the myth that gets repeated and repeated and repeated spreads in the society. And that's what's happening in Kashmir also. There are lots of myths that are going along. And whenever you hear TV debates, you find the Pakistanis putting in the accession was not complete, or the R-370, or you didn't have plebiscite, or the people of the valley are Muslim majority, so it belongs to the Muslims. All these myths are going around. So I'll throw some light on each one of them for you all, so that you know exactly what it is. If we talk of Kashmir, in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, everybody has a perception in today's time that Kashmir is a Muslim majority state, it belongs to the Muslims, it does belong to them, but it also belongs to the others who live in that state. But it comes with, it belongs to them, and it as though it has been theirs for a very, very long time, you know. So if you look at Nirmit Puran, because I know many of you are Indians who must have read a lot of it, in chapter 1, Raja Jamnijaya will ask Rishi Resham Payam, you know who Raja Jamnijaya and Rishi Resham Payam are,
yes.
You know. And he'll ask, jab Mahabharat hua tha, to Kashmir ke Raja kyun nahi aaye the? You know, that means Kashmir was Kashmir even then. Then if you read Kalhan's Raj Tarangi, you find that he has described it was the complete history from Neel's time, the first king, you know. But people may say, okay, ye mythology hai ya sachai hai? But look at it, there was Lalit Aditya in 1699. His empire, 1699, around that time. I may be wrong a few years here and there, you know. But Karkota dynasty of Kashmir that was there. And his empire spread from Kaveri right up to the Caspian Sea, from up to Assam. So, and Kashmir was the capital of his empire, and it was Kashmir even then. You see, so Kashmir has been Kashmir for a very long time, you know. And then you talk of Sharda Peeth, we've all heard of it. You know, these are the facts which you talk of, you know. Sharda Peeth has been there. Where in the 6th, it is the 6th or the 7th century when Shankaracharya came as Adi Shankar to Kashmir, you know. And they opened the south door of the Sharda Peeth for him, you know. And they had a vaad vivaad. That's the way it was done those days. If you came with different schools of thoughts, you sat across the table, you had a lot of discussions. and you accepted something of theirs, and you know, you gave in to some and you took some. So he came out as Adi Shankaracharya from there, you know. So this was, Kashmir was even Kashmir then, and it was called Kashmir. You have, he spoke of Mahayana Buddhism. It originated from there, you know. Then there are many, many, many such things that have originated. Even your Patanjali, if you look at it, not Ramdev's Patanjali, but the, you know. So it was also from Kashmir, you know. And in the first, second millennium, you had Abhinav Gupta. We all have heard of Abhinav Gupta, Kashmiri Shaivism, you know, or Abhinav Bharati, you know, that translation. They say if you had to understand Bharat Munim's Natya Shastra, you had to understand, you had to read Abhinav Bharati, you know. So Kashmir was Kashmir even then. So when the Kashmiri Pandits talk of Kashmir, you know, or if you talk of Kashmiri Panditon ka jo panchang hai, it's called Saptarishi Panchang, you know. Then that is the current year going on in 2017 is 5093 to be exact. That means for so many years we've had our, which gave our lunar days, which gave our rituals, which gives, we call it Janampatri, you know, or Nichpatri, we call it Nichpatri, you know? Nichpatri, yeah. So that gives a complete detail of our lunar days, our functions, our rituals, how to do it and all. And that is 5093. So first, you can understand, as he rightly said, so many years we've been there, you know, and for us, it's not a piece of land that we are talking about. It is our identity, it's our astitva, it's our Indianism, you know, it's our civilization. So when somebody tells us that, you know, Kashmir mein toh aap log the nahi, aapko Jagmohan ji ne nikal diya tha, jaan, it hurts us, you know, because we were the originals. Like the, sometime back we had Bashir Manzar, I don't know if all of you have heard of him. He's a journalist from Kashmir, and he came to Mumbai to a Kalina University to talk about his, you know, the Kashmir mein, what is happening to the Muslims there. So I told him, Bashir ji, I can't even hate you. So he says, why? I said, because originally you were a Kashmiri Pandit till 1339. So it's my blood that is still there, my DNA into you. So I can't even hate you fully. Not that I hate any one of them, because hate is not a good thing to have in you. But, you know, so he just looked at me and, you know, he didn't know what to do. So he was polite, of course, he was very polite, I grant him that, you know. So you have, so Kashmir was, that was the original Kashmir, you know, that was accepted. So today's Kashmir, when you talk of the, all these myths that have come up, you know, that Kashmir was a, is a Muslim Kashmir. Kashmir was originally also Muslim, so they should get, and Azadi, that's another thing that they come up with, Azadi. Yes, you have heard what Pakistan, if Pakistan could do that to itself, what it has done, if it is doing what it is doing to the US, you know, troubling, you can understand what it does to us, where it's our immediate neighbor, you know. So there is a lot of infiltration, there's a lot of, because 47, I'm sure you wouldn't have won if wars were won only by the army, you know. That's why Pakistan lost Bangladesh, you see. We wouldn't have got Kashmir in 47 too, let's be fair. This about people, Muslims there were on our side at that time, we have to understand, you know. And there was no murder or something till 1980s, so I, or 80s or 90s, early 80s, because Kashmir Muslims were also not so aggressive. But this radicalization and Islamization and Pakistan in interference into affairs, and of course neglect on our side. We have also neglected all our border states. That's why you had Punjab problem, that's why you have Northeast problems, and that's why you have Kashmir problems. And the governments have been neglecting it in the past, not the present one, of course. But people also have to put in, chip in their bit. And the chip in comes in by being aware of it, you know, aware of what belongs to you, why it belongs to you, and how you can keep it, you see. So for the Kashmir region, we spread about a lot of awareness on the various aspects of legal and constitutional holding of Kashmir. Because most of the time on TV debates and all, you see these Pakistanis saying, but accession was not there. Not only they, even Sheila Rashid Shora, if you know of her, she was an intern in my company, you know. And I was generous enough to keep her as an intern. And she was about 15 days after she left my company, and I saw her on NDTV talking about Azadi. You see? So I kept on monitoring her. And then there was a function in which she said, but the accession is not complete. So I had to get up and tell them how the accession was complete according to what government laws that were set and how accession happened. So each and every state followed the same method of accession. Initially for three things. Yes, every state that was coming to your constituent assembly had to be set. They were supposed to have their own constitution, but many of them opted out. You have to understand that, but many of them opted and they're out and they said, we don't want it. We will come into the constituent assembly that is to be forming the constitution of India. You see, the main constitution, and they were put into, and that's why there were representatives from all the states in the constituent assembly that was supposed to form the Indian constitution, you see. And how did then this 370 came in? There's another myth about it. They say the word that it is special, you know, that which is in the chapter head. We have to understand legally, the chapter head defines, it doesn't, each and every word in the chapter does not imply to each and every article, you know. So that word special that was added in 1962 or 72, one of the 2 years. I'm not very good with dates, so you all can remember, look for it. Nagaland, you know. So the word special, so then I was wondering, why are they using this word special for Kashmir every time? How did it happen? And you find that in the parliamentary discussions that were happening, when 370 was coming in, you know, the word used was that in Kashmir, there are special conditions. You get my point? So these words that are loosely used later on come from, so they have a source. So they say, if you do not understand how the law applies or an article of a constitution of India, you look into the external aids. External aid is a parliamentary discussion that's happening, you know. So when you look at the parliamentary discussion, you find they said it is a special condition in Jammu and Kashmir because there's a war going on there, you know. So we cannot, you know, right now have a constitution. So let's give them a temporary and transitional. We'll not get into the political discussions that followed during that time for the word, but the article was temporary and transitional, you know. So they were granted the temporary and transitional positioning, which was to be given to the constituent assembly. The constituent assembly was supposed to withdraw it with the president's signature, whatever, but it didn't happen for whatever reason. Then comes that 35, that we had this special thing of PRCs, that is state subjection, which they have picked up from the Maharaj. I'm going fast so that you have some idea on all the points that come as dispute, and then you can one can do more study on it. 35A came in as a presidential order, you know. So you cannot, and this article was put into our constitution. It is not put into the main body of the constitution. So when we are wondering, when we are an academic group that's studying of how things are coming about. So when we are studying and we don't find 35A in the main body of the constitution, we go for Google search. Okay, and we find 35A is mentioned there. And then when we search, we find it is in the appendix. Now it is not in the main body of the constitution because it has been passed by the, am I crossing the time? No. It has been passed by the presidential order. Now, no article can come into the constitution. It is not passed as a bill into the parliament, discussed and then passed. So you understand the fraud that wrong that could, I wouldn't say the fraud, the wrong that can happen. So these are the things that are the things which they throw around on you. Then they say the plebiscite is not complete. You all know how you went, we went to the UN, but we went under chapter 6. You know what, chapter 6 is not compulsory, it's not binding to whatever decision. And you went under article 35. Article 35 doesn't talk of dispute really, it talks of territorial disturbance that's happened around you. And if you do not take charge of it, then we can, we can also give it back to them. And that will disturb the peace of the region. You see, under 35, article 35 of chapter 6, if you look at it, then that is what you went for. So when they say you went for it as a dispute, we didn't go for it as a dispute. We said it's a territorial disturbance because of the invasion of Pakistan into our territory, you know. And then the UN gave its fine. And of course they say, but this happened in the UN, and there were a lot of stages in the UN as we were going through this process, and that happens with any negotiation. There are a lot of stages that happen. You give a lot of information. They correct their, you know, whatever is the action that has to be taken. But the final 1948 resolution was that they have to withdraw the army. They didn't tell us to withdraw our army because it belonged to us. They have to completely withdraw their army. The tribals also have to withdraw. People have to go back to their places. Peace has to be maintained, and India keeps the minimum forces. What is important is India is allowed to keep the minimum forces because the place belongs to us. And then they said plebiscite. You know, that plebiscite should happen. And there were objections also put in by the Indian government that if it does not happen within a time frame, we will, because plebiscite is the will of the people, you know. So we will do it in our own form. And that was done in 1954 by forming a constituent assembly there, you know. And then they ratified that Jammu and Kashmir is an integral part of India. And also for the princely states to become a part of you, there was a process. There has been a process. First is the proclamation of the Maharaja of the state, you know, and that on 25th of November, 1949, you know, Karan Singh signed that proclamation saying the constitution of India becomes, we fall into the constitution of India. You know, then it was ratified, and then second stage for all states were that it had to be ratified by their assembly, and it was ratified that this is an integral part of India. And if you look at their clause 3, it says that the section 3 of the Jammu and Kashmir constitution, section 5 says if there is a dispute between the parliament, between their constitution and the Indian parliament, the parliament of India is supreme, you know. And section 147 says you cannot bring about any change into in these two articles. So somehow it's all closed and done. We have to get that very clear that it's all closed and done, you know. But now talking of how this terrorism has had, do we have the time? Or there's another speaker? Few minutes. Okay, we all, 2 minutes. Okay, we all know how the terrorism has happened there, or what is happening. Another cause that's very, not only are the locals suffering, they're suffering a lot. We may think that they're enjoying it because most of the people there don't want this kind of azadi which they are talking about, you see. So they are suffering. The Kashmiri Pandits are suffering, the West Pakistanis are suffering, the Safai Karamcharis are suffering, the border displaced people are suffering. So it's not that there's only one person suffering there. Everybody is suffering because of these activities that are going around that state. And Pakistan, of course, most of it, but I don't like to say it because I feel that, you know, I as a citizen of India, you know, and a country should be able to protect my things. That's what I feel. Thank you.